Welcome to Fireside Chat with Kashmir Hill, investigative reporter at the New York Times in the technology section and author of Your Face Belongs to Us. We are here at the Cornell Tech University. I'm the Associate Dean of Studies for the Executive MBA in Digital Leadership at HAWEZ, the University of Applied Science in Business Administration in Zurich. And it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you here with us. We are on a study tour through the US, through Boston and New York, and it is right now in this room an audience of business executives from Switzerland listening in. We want to learn from experts like you how we can use technology for good, but also what we might be thinking about as we navigate some of its challenges. And Kashmir Hill, it is such a pleasure to sit down with you for this Fireside Chat. Welcome.
Thank you, Sunnie.
So let's launch right into it. I don't know how many have read this book who are watching this video. I'm certain that everyone here in the live audience has. Tell us a little bit about it if one has not yet had the opportunity. Why should one read it, and what are maybe some of the key points to know about it?
Yeah, so it is a book about facial recognition technology and the rise of AI. And specifically this company, Clearview AI, which is a little New York-based startup that scraped billions of photos from the public internet, including social media sites, without the permission of anyone whose face they were scraping. They currently have 30 billion faces in their database. And they created this tool where you can take a photo of somebody and find all the other places on the internet where their photo appears. So it's a way of finding out someone's name, who they're friends with, their social media profiles, even finding photos that they may not know are on the internet. And at the time that I first discovered the company's existence in the fall of 2019, they were secretly selling it to law enforcement agencies around the country and around the world.
How did you hear about it?
Yeah, so it was in November 2019. I was actually in Switzerland not be able to pronounce the name of where we were, Gertsensee. And I was doing a young leaders fellowship with the Swiss American Foundation. So it was there for a week, and it was around midnight. I was quite pregnant at the time. I think I was 7 months pregnant. Was my last international trip, and was going to bed. I think the other members of the program were staying up late, but I was very tired. And I checked my email, and I had a message from a public records researcher that I knew from the privacy security space. And he had been asking police departments around the country, around the United States, what facial recognition technologies they were using and how much they were paying for it. And at that point, you know, police in the US had been using facial recognition technology for two decades. But as far as the public knew, it was very clunky. The algorithms didn't really work that well. It wasn't, as far as we knew, a very powerful tool for law enforcement. And they were only searching kind of criminal mugshot databases, maybe some government photos from state driver's licenses. But he stumbled across this company called Clearview AI that claimed that it had, you know, scraped billions of photos from the public web. And the way Freddie put it to me is that that they were selling Facebook photos to the police. And you know, there was this memo, and it was a lawyer kind of describing what they'd done. And the memo had been written to reassure police in the United States that they could use this tool without breaking the law. And so, very intriguing tip. And even though it was midnight, I called Freddie, the public records researcher, and told him, I'm really interested, and I want to pursue the story, and I'll be back in the United States on Monday.
Wow.
And I wanted to find out, had this company really done it? Why had I never heard of them before, and who were the people behind it?
And in the book, you describe then, you know, this incredible journey. When did you know this is no longer just an article, an investigative reporting piece that I'm writing, but really this is a full-fledged book?
Clearview, just from the very beginning, was such an unusual company. They went to great lengths to kind of, even though they were exposing so much about all of us with their tool, they were trying to stay in the shadows. And so they had kind of hidden who was connected to the company. They actually tried to deter my reporting by putting an alert on my face so that when I started talking to police officers about the app, when they went to show me what the results looked like, and when they uploaded my photo, the company would know and call them and tell them to stop talking to me. And so from the very beginning, I just was thinking this startup is acting very strange. It's really intriguing. And as I found out more about them, it was just such a colorful cast of characters involved. I mean, really like a ragtag group that was able to build this powerful tool. And I just was interested in the technology itself, how we got to this moment, you know, who had worked on this, how did facial recognition technology get so powerful? And it was really a story about AI and just the decades of work that have gone into making these powerful tools from facial recognition technology to ChatGPT. And I was just pitching more and more stories to my editors at the New York Times, and two of them said, you should do a book. And it really did feel like such a necessary moment to reflect on this and to think about whether we want this to exist, this ability to link all of us, our faces, to everything that's knowable about us on the internet, because it really means the end of anonymity as we know it.
You once said Clearview AI didn't achieve a technological breakthrough, but an ethical one. And I'd love to hear a bit more, what do you mean by this?
Yeah, so in the book, I call this ethical arbitrage. And when I first found out about Clearview AI, I assumed that there was some technological mastermind who was involved in the startup who had been able to do this. I mean, build a tool that can search the whole internet for a face. You know, how did this little company do this before a big technology giant like Google or Facebook or Meta, as it's called now? And I never quite found that mastermind at Clearview AI. Instead, what I found out is that Google and Facebook had both developed this technology internally years earlier. You know, Google as early as 2011, their then chairman, Eric Schmidt, said that facial recognition technology like this that could identify a stranger was the one technology that Google had built and held back because they thought it was too dangerous. I think they would update that now, that Google made a similar decision about generative AI tools. But Facebook, I got to watch this video taken in a conference room in Menlo Park of these Facebook engineers sitting around in a room, and they had a smartphone strapped to the brim of a baseball cap standing up so that when they looked at somebody, you know, it would look at you, the camera would take in your face, and it would call out Sunnie. And so they had developed this internally, and they said, you know, these are not companies that are known necessarily for being conservative when it comes to new data uses, but they said that this was a step too far. And what had happened is that the tools to build a technology like this had become more generally available so that somebody with just some technical savvy like Clearview AI was able to eventually develop these technologies not unexpectedly, but it took a while to get there. And so what Clearview had done was not a technical breakthrough. It was that they were willing to do what other companies hadn't been willing to do. And it's because they were a small startup and they just had less to lose, I think, than a Google or Facebook by putting this radical superpower out there.
So in the book, one of the things I find fascinating is how much color you provide in terms of the protagonists. And can you share a bit more about these main protagonists? Because Clearview AI now sounds like, I guess, you know, a company, an institution, but really, as you say, it's a startup, and a startup starts with a founder. So could you share a little bit about the people?
Yeah, so the technical founder of Clearview AI is a guy named Juan Tontat. He grew up in Australia, was one of those people who was just always obsessed with computers and technology from a really early age, kind of taught himself to code by watching free videos from MIT online. And he went to college for computer science and was bored, essentially dropped out and moved across the world to San Francisco to chase the tech boom. He was 19 years old, and he got there in 2007, which is the time when the iPhone was first coming out. Facebook had just opened up its doors to third-party developers, and he was kind of just throwing spaghetti at the wall to see what stuck, trying to create like a popular app. He made Facebook quizzes and iPhone games. Eventually, he made an app called Trump Hair, which would just put, you know, the former president's hair on people's heads in photos. I mean, really just kind of trivial, you know, applications. And eventually, he moved from San Francisco to New York and kind of fell in with a more conservative crowd, the Make America Great Again kind of crowd that was surrounding Trump when he was running for president. And so it's amazing to me that with this kind of background, I mean, I asked him at one point, you know, how did you go from making Facebook quizzes to this incredibly powerful facial recognition app? And he said, I was standing on the shoulders of giants, meaning all these people that had been doing this research on AI and facial recognition algorithms. He was able to basically get that research because it's just freely provided now on GitHub, on the web. He was really taking advantage of the open source movement. But really, such a curious and fascinating character. He did tell me, you know, he was radicalized online during that time when he was a Trump supporter. And now he says he is, you know, too busy working on Clearview AI to kind of be involved in political movements.
So there's always the founder, then there's the team, and then there's the investors. And given what you just said in terms of falling into more of the conservative crowd, can you share a little bit about your research around the early stage investors, the first believers? Because, you know, many technologies really only come about because of this, well, this symbiotic relationship where at the end of the day, some investors want to see this technology succeed.
Right. So the idea for what became Clearview AI developed actually at the Republican National Convention in 2016 when Trump was the candidate. And while he was there, he had the chance to meet Peter Thiel, who's a very famous American investor, venture capitalist, co-founder of PayPal, early investor in Facebook, co-founder of Palantir, another data mining company. And when Juan Tontat and his team, at least two other kind of people he was working with at the time, first started doing this, kind of scraping photos from the internet, one of the first sites they got it from was Venmo, a social payments app here in the United States. He went back to Peter Thiel and said, hey, we're making this tool that you can search somebody's face and find their social media profiles. And so Thiel was ended up giving them $200,000. He was the first investor. And it's really why Clearview AI exists today. They kept trying to get investment from other people. But one problem they had is that they were a company with a product in search of customers. And they had built this thing that worked fairly well at finding people on the internet, but they weren't sure what to do with it, like who wanted to buy this. And so they were going to investors and pitching it, and originally they were thinking, we'll sell this to private companies. And so they would actually give the tool out to investors to try out. And so they went to San Francisco, they went to kind of the big investment firms, and those investors would try out the app, and they liked using it. They liked using it at bars, you know, at parties, as a party trick, you know, impress dates. Use it at business meetings when you forget somebody's name that you should know, and you could quickly snap a photo of their face and now know who they are. But none of those big VC firms like the Sequoias of the world, which Juan Tontak calls the Harvard of the venture capital world, ended up investing in Clearview because though the partners at the firms liked using the app personally, they had concerns about Clearview, about how it had sourced its data. And some investors told me they were disturbed a little bit by the conservative leanings of some of the early people involved in the company.
So now that Clearview AI exists, you know, is privacy as we know it over?
So that is a question that the book is asking, is in this moment when Clearview AI exists, you know, as I said, this is a company that exists because of ethical arbitrage, and they are not the only company to realize they can build a tool like this. There are other public face search engines on the web right now. Clearview AI is limited to law enforcement, but websites like PimEyes.com and FaceCheck.id give you the same power. You know, you can get a subscription or sometimes even for free, upload someone's face and find out where else it is on the internet. And so we are at this place right now where anonymity as we know it is threatened. And so the book looks at ways that these kind of technologies have been constrained, and we're seeing different places handle it differently. Basically, your face is differently protected depending on where you live in the world. And I think that you can constrain technology. I don't think that we have to let our future be dictated by what technology is capable of. And so I don't think that privacy as we know it is over unless that's how what we choose, unless we decide we want facial recognition technology to be ubiquitous and we want everyone identifiable, we want governments to be, you know, tracking us on surveillance cameras everywhere we go, we want companies to be able to, you know, identify us as we walk through the door, we want all of us to have an app like this on our phone where you can constantly identify somebody. I hope that we don't choose that path, because I think that anonymity is really important for kind of just our ability to move through the world and be comfortable. And I think privacy is important. So I hope that we don't go that route.
I mean, one question I got, and I asked a few experts in the field to submit questions to me for this conversation. And one question I got was around the supply chain of data. What do you think we need to put in place as this hunt for data and building databases that then end up powering tools like this that invade privacy, invade facial privacy in that sense? You know, what do we need to be thinking about in terms of maybe setting ourselves up for better data supply chains?
Well, this is the question of the AI age, right? Because what Clearview AI did is it went out and collected all these faces from all over the internet, from companies like Facebook and LinkedIn and Instagram. But we're seeing the same behavior by lots of different artificial intelligence-based companies, you know, OpenAI, ChatGPT. These tools were developed by going out on the internet and just collecting, you know, data en masse, and not necessarily with anyone's consent. And so there's this big question of, is it okay for these companies to kind of source everything that's on the public commons of the internet? If they do that, do they need to be transparent about where the data is coming from? What about rights holders? I mean, with generative AI, artists have gotten very upset to have, you know, their work used to train these models that then can replace their, you know, their output, their livelihood. So it's a big question. Regarding faces specifically, privacy regulators, kind of inspired by the Clearview AI case, put out a warning to AI companies and said, hey, just because there is information on the internet publicly available doesn't mean that you have the right to it. It can still be private, it can still have personal rights to it, especially if it's on a social media site. And if you collect this information, you may be violating our privacy laws.
Do you see any legal cases right now that you are following closely around this subject? I mean, this seems like it's just a moment of shifting public perception to some degree, and I think some people are waking up to it. Are there any cases you're following or particular developments that you're looking to with maybe a closer look than many of us?
Well, clearly AI is a great canary in the coal mine of AI. Like, how are regulators handling this? And, you know, in the US, we just do not have a federal or a national privacy law. And so in the US, it's being handled kind of state by state. Some states have stronger privacy regimes here than others. But, you know, outside of the United States, you all have very different and stronger privacy regimes. And so when Clearview AI was exposed, regulators in Europe, data privacy regulators in Europe and Australia and in Canada all said that what Clearview AI had done was illegal, that they couldn't just collect, you know, their citizens' photos and put them in a database without their consent. And many of them, you know, told Clearview AI, what you did is illegal, delete our citizens. Some of them fined Clearview AI, including the UK, Italy, France, and Greece, kind of gave them the maximum fine of 20 million euros under the GDPR. But Clearview is just not responding to these orders. You know, they're appealing the decisions. They were actually just recently able to overturn the UK privacy regulator's fine under jurisdiction reasons. And the UK court there, and it could still be appealed by the privacy regulator in Britain, but the court said that, you know, the UK's privacy regulator doesn't have jurisdiction over how other governments are using Clearview AI, because Clearview AI is just working with law enforcement in the US. So it's very complicated. For a while, Clearview AI was respecting GDPR, and if you were in Europe, you could go to Clearview and say that you want to get out of their database. They recently told me they're not respecting GDPR anymore, and they're not honoring opt-outs or deletion requests from European citizens. So, I mean, it is a great example of how challenging this is. How do we regulate these companies that are gathering information from around the world, but based in places that don't have a strong privacy regime? So I'm very closely watching to see what happens with Clearview.
Fascinating. How do you see, I don't know how closely you've focused on different countries, how do you see Switzerland's perhaps role or also efforts in the area of data protection, particularly as it relates to biometric information? We are, you know, aligned with General Data Protection Regulation and the Digital Service Act introduced by the European Union. But sort of what are your thoughts perhaps specifically to Switzerland, if you have any?
Yeah, I mean, Europe is definitely out ahead of the U.S. in terms of privacy restrictions, and we are getting basically trickle-down privacy law in the U.S. from Europe. In Switzerland specifically, it was interesting because after I told the Clearview story, there were a couple of researchers there, journalists, who said, wow, what Clearview AI did, anyone can do. And so they actually did this project where they scraped photos from Instagram and Facebook that were related to big Swiss events. And then they took the faces of a bunch of Swiss politicians and they essentially searched through these events looking for the faces of the politicians. And they found some interesting photos. I think at one point they found nude photos of one of the politicians at a public event, and they went to the politicians and said, hey, like, don't you think we shouldn't be able to do this? And they said, yes, like, that is a violation of privacy and you shouldn't do that. And they said, the Swiss privacy regulator said, it's great that you demonstrated that this is possible, but you really shouldn't do that again. So yeah, I mean, Switzerland and Europe have a nice framework in place for dealing with something like this, saying, no, you shouldn't be taking people's personal information off the internet and just sticking it in your database. But there's the problem of enforcing that law in a global context.
Do you think more countries will follow suit? Do you think that, you know, Europe is leading the way, or is this just you know, one of the regional solutions? And if it's only one, what other solutions do you hope to see emerge?
Yeah, I mean, in the U.S., people are definitely paying attention to what happens in Europe and how they're thinking about regulation of AI, regulation of biometric information, privacy. In the U.S., where we are seeing privacy laws happen, which is the state level, so far it's been a different approach. In Europe, the rule is don't put people in databases without their permission. In the US, in where we do have privacy laws, it says let people get out of the databases, so allow them to delete themselves, which is such a different approach. And opt-out laws just are not as effective. And I looked at this for California, which is a state with something like 34 million people. They have a law that says you can go to Clearview AI and ask to be deleted. In the last 2 years, fewer than 1,000 people have done that. So this just isn't as effective as the European approach. We do have one state in the United States with a very strong law around biometric information that says you can't use people's face prints or fingerprints or voice print, you know, without consent if you're a company. And or face a very big fine. And that's been an effective law. We've seen it. My favorite example of how the law affects behavior is there is a venue here in New York City called Madison Square Garden. It's a big events venue, a lot of big rock bands, you know, performances happen there. The Knicks play there, the Rangers play there, big sports teams. And they installed facial recognition technology a few years ago to address security threats. And people who had been violent in the stadium or known stalkers of celebrities that they didn't want to get in, which is how Taylor Swift has used facial recognition technology at her concerts. But in the last year, the owner of Madison Square Garden said, well, actually, we could use facial recognition technology to keep out my enemies, people I don't like, namely lawyers who work at law firms that have sued MSG and its various companies and cost us a lot of money. And so they went to the law firm's websites, scraped the photos of the lawyers from the website, thousands of lawyers at dozens of firms, and put them on this ban list so that they can't come into events at the stadium anymore. And I actually went there with one of the lawyers that was on the ban list. She works for a personal injury firm. And you know, there's thousands of people that are streaming into MSG. We walked through the doors, put our bags on the security belt. By the time we pick them up, a security guard approaches us and asks her for ID and says, you're not welcome here. You have to leave. You can't come back until, you know, your firm drops the case or the litigation is resolved. And so it was really just this astounding. I'd been working on this book for a few years, and I was still shocked to see a business kind of wielding the technology that way. But it shows what companies can do with a tool like this, you know, keep out their enemies, keep out their critics, write a bad, you know, Google review, and maybe you're never allowed inside the venue again. Just ways that you could discriminate against people based on what's knowable about them from their face. But Madison Square Garden also owns a theater in Chicago, and it couldn't use facial recognition technology this way because of that law in Illinois that says you can't use biometrics without consent. That you would need to get the lawyer's permission to ban them by face. And so we are seeing, you know, a kind of patchwork of laws here, but really just nothing consistent, whereas Europe seems like it is a little bit, farther ahead of us in terms of addressing it.
So it sounds like, when I listen to you, initially the book was written from a perspective of investigative fascination. And then now we've entered, you know, a place from just the last few minutes of our conversation where it's about so much more. And if you now look back, as you've been touring the country, this book just came out in September 2023. It's been, you know, incredibly well received. You've had so many conversations across the entire nation and beyond. You know, why do you think today that you had to write this book?
Well, I think that this is just a huge change for us. This idea that your face is knowable, you know, that you can walk into any company and any business, and they could know about you in the same way they'd know about you online, you know, when you visit their website, that they have essentially cookies, like real world cookies attached to your face, and they know what your spending potential is, what your political beliefs might be, you know, what you've bought there in the past. I mean, that is very powerful. And I just think that we really need to think about whether we want governments to have this power to track us, whether we want companies to have that power to know so much about us when we walk in the door. And again, whether we want all of us to be able to, you know, listen in on a private conversation over dinner and then find out who the people are who are having that conversation. Technologically, that is all possible right now. But I think it's important that we think of a policy and legal framework to maintain our privacy and our ability to kind of live our lives with some sense of control and anonymity over when we're identified and what's knowable about us. Because otherwise, I think the real world becomes much like it is online, where you feel like you're always tracked. You know, people know too much about you, that this kind of sense of unease and creepiness will just be part of our daily lives. And so I did think it's important to write this book now to address that, kind of create the world that we want to live in as opposed to letting what's possible with the technology dictate it.
We are an executive MBA in digital leadership. So at the end of the day, a lot of what we care about is what are the questions leaders should be thinking about, and then debating those and empowering them to find better answers. So what are, perhaps as we close this conversation, some of the questions you would want to leave leaders with from across the sector, private and public? We're also here hosted by the Public Interest Technology Initiative of Cornell Tech. You know, I think this is very much a conversation around what is in the public interest as well. So what are the questions you would leave leaders with?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's so many decisions that businesses are going to make that will determine kind of what's the norm with facial recognition technology. Google and Meta developing this and deciding to hold it back, I think, was a very powerful decision. I think they delayed kind of by 10 years approximately this kind of power getting out there. Thinking about the Madison Square Gardens of the world and how you will deploy kind of facial recognition technology and biometric information, and just having an ethical framework for the deployment of technology, because just because you can do it technologically and legally even, maybe you shouldn't. And so I think that's going to be increasingly important across all of the AI technologies, having a very strong ethical framework for, do we deploy these technologies? How and what is society comfortable with in terms of ingesting information, collecting information about them, analyzing them? I'm just seeing this happen across so many different industries. And because the rules are not in place yet, I think there's it's very important how companies are thinking about it and kind of safeguarding people's information.
Maybe a last word. You referenced the American Swiss Foundation. As we think about also diplomatic relations in the world and technology, what are some of the things you hope nation states will consider as they engage, as well as leaders, in the policy making of in many ways also helping to shape the use of technology?
I mean, privacy is clearly a global conversation, and countries need to be talking to each other about what this should look like, because these companies are operating globally and collecting information globally. And if there's not some kind of conversation or cooperation between different companies, it is going to be impossible to regulate them.
Kashmir Hill, thank you so, so much. It's been such an insightful fireside chat. I really hope that many leaders around the world, be it in business, be it in politics, do take these thoughts, these questions to heart, and find better answers as we navigate the future of technology. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sunnie.